Welcome to the presentation of the Symbolic Execution Debugger. We will present three examples highlighting typical application scenarios of the tool. The first one is simple and designed to explain symbolic execution and how the debugger performs it. Symbolic execution means to execute a program with symbolic values instead of concrete values. This allows us to discover all feasible program execution paths simultaneously. The debugger allows to start execution directly at any method or even at a single statement. Because symbolic values are used, there is no need to find input values which bring execution to the point of interest. All to be done is to select the element of interest and to start debugging via context menu item debug as symbolic execution debug. Switch next into the symbolic debug perspective, which provides all relevant views for symbolic execution. Execution can be done stepwise or resumed until a defined breakpoint is reached. Let's do it stepwise and have a closer look on how symbolic execution works. The root is always a start node representing the program fragment to execute. We are interested in method equals, which we call now by performing a step into. The next step is to execute the first statement. Before we do it, let us inspect the current symbolic state shown in few variables. Here, the JavaSys reference is named self and has an instance field content. Both are assigned with symbolic values named after them. At this point, we know nothing about parameter n. It can be null or a reference to an existing object. If multiple values are possible, the tool shows the conditions under which each value is valid. In case that n points to an object, then there is again the instance field content. The exception variable is used by the debugger to identify if an execution path terminates normally or with an uncaught exception. Now we continue symbolic execution with the if statement. We have not enough knowledge about the symbolic state to follow a single path. Consequently, symbolic execution splits into several branches to cover all feasible execution paths. The result is a so-called symbolic execution tree. The conditions under which each path is taken are shown as branch condition nodes. The right branch is taken if n is null. In this case, a null pointer exception is thrown and execution terminates with this uncaught exception. Otherwise, the if condition may evaluate either to true or to false. For the else branch, when instance variable content of self and n has different values, the return statement is executed next. Now, the end of method equals is reached and false is returned as method result. Finally, execution terminates normally without a sworn exception. The then branch is taken when instance variable content of self and n has the same value. Rather than executing the then branch stepwise, we click on resume to finish execution. Compared to the else branch, we can see that true is returned instead of false. Additional details about the select node are shown in the properties view. For instance, the path condition restricts the initial state to ensure that the current path is taken. Here, n has to be not null, and the content of self and n has to be the same. This can also be seen in the symbolic state. N can't be null anymore, and both content fields of n and self have the same value. But what about n and self? The path condition is fulfilled if both are different objects with the same value, but also if both point to the same object. Aliasing is a common source of bugs, and the symbolic execution debugger allows to visualize all possible memory layouts of the current state. Simply click on Visualize Memory Layouts and switch into the state visualization perspective. The OM editor shows a symbolic object diagram similar to a UML object diagram. The root node represents a state. Its local variables point to objects on the heap. Here, both objects are different but have the same content. We can switch to an alternative memory layout in which n and self point to the same object. No other non-isomorphic memory layouts exist. It is also possible to inspect the initial memory layout before execution started. Here it is the same because nothing was changed in the current execution path. Before we continue with the next example, let us clean up the debugging session. First we close the editor, and second we terminate and remove it. We will use the symbolic execution debugger now in a more realistic example to locate the origin of a bug. Imagine a large application and the user reports that she experienced a Stack Overflow error. It seems that method sort calls itself recursively until the stack is full. Using a traditional debugger, we would have to find input values to reproduce the failure first, as already done in order to demonstrate the error. In the traditional setting, we could set a breakpoint in the beginning of method sort to suspend execution. From this point on, we would execute the method stepwise to comprehend the situation, a time-consuming and tedious task. Using the symbolic execution debugger, we can do better, because execution can start directly at method sort. Also in the symbolic setting, we control execution until we find something unexpected. First, method sort is called. The first and only statement calls then the helper method. This requires to access numbers.length, which splits execution into two branches, as array may be null. But in actual program 1, the null pointer exception is not possible. This is ensured by assert statements of the constructor. Small execution starts in an arbitrary state, and this kind of knowledge is not available by default. But we can add it as precondition to the debug configuration. Just specify that numbers is not null, and that numbers.length is greater or equal to 1. To use the new precondition, we need to restart our debugging session. And we start over again as before. First, sort is called, which invokes the helper method. This time, execution does not split anymore, and the if statement will be executed next. Surprisingly, symbolic execution does not split. This means that the then branch is always executed. Missing expected split or unexpected splits may indicate a bug in the source code. Further inspection shows that the if guide is indeed erroneous. So let us correct it. It should be a lesser than comparison. After terminating the debugging sessions, we can execute the application again and see that the bug is gone. In the last example, we will use the symbolic execution debugger to review our code and to demonstrate how specifications can be used during symbolic execution. Method index of returns the first error index accepted by the filter. Filter is an interface for which no concrete implementation is available. The behavior of a program is specified using the Java modeling language JML. The method contract specifies that the method can be called in any state and ensures that no exception will be thrown. Observe that the method contract of index of is incomplete but still sufficient for debugging. Its method contract requires only that the invariant of parameter filter is satisfied. Loops are unrolled by default during symbolic execution. Loop invariants can be applied instead to guarantee a finite symbolic execution tree even if the number of loop iterations has no fixed bound. A loop invariant is a formula which has to be preserved by any loop iteration. To find a suitable loop invariant can be a difficult task. However, for debugging, loop invariants can be much weaker than required for verification. Before we start debugging, we modify the debug configuration to use the method contract. The method's precondition restricts the initial state, while the fulfillment of the postcondition is checked in each termination node. So, let's start. If we would resume execution, the loop would be unrolled once and execution would stop because no filter implementation is available. To avoid this, we configure the symbolic execution engine to apply contracts and loop invariants instead. Resume execution results in a final symbolic execution tree which covers the complete program behavior. Let's have a closer look at the symbolic execution tree. The loop is dealt with by applying its loop invariant. This splits execution into two branches. The body preserved branch represents an arbitrary loop iteration. Improving the layout and readability of the conditions is future work. However, we can see by the red cross termination icon that the loop invariant is not preserved. The index variable I is not increased when an element is accepted. This breaks the termination condition of the loop invariant. The debugger-like interface allows easily to comprehend specified loop invariants and in particular to understand why they might not be satisfied by a program. A huge help when verifying programs. At last, the use case branch continues after the loop. Although the loop invariant is not preserved, we can spot another problem. Inspecting the return nodes, we can see that the loop counter variable I is returned instead of the found index. Did you get interested in the symbolic execution debugger? If yes, try it out. The debugger is available as an Eclipse plugin and compatible with Eclipse 3.7 Indigo on Lua. The required update sites and additional information about the tool are available at keyproject.org. Thank you for watching the presentation of the symbolic execution debugger.